So, welcome to everyone to this new event within the Hidden App webinar series. I know we're very close to the spring break, but we wish anyway we could be here and have this very interesting webinar. With Chiara Zuanni from Austria. I think you all remember Chiara because she already participated in our events, in particular on Hidden Charts. And today we are really looking forward to hearing from her about digital tools and practice enhanced learning. In museums. I just wanted to give you a few very short information regarding Eden, a network of academics and professionals and services that we offer to our membership, in particular, of course, webinars and Eden chart, and in fact, we will have one after the webinar at 6 later tonight. Just to tell you that what we want to be actually for the membership is a lively community and the Eden NAP, Network of Academics and Professionals, is made of all the members, of course, and a steering committee that I chair. We try to support members, as we were saying, through communication, networking, helping the community to build a personal portfolio and also being a meeting point where new groups can be created. This is the steering committee. I think all of you know the faces and the names of the people directly involved. If you're coming to the conference, the annual conference in Bruges next June, you'll meet them face to face, which is always something good to do in order to strengthen relationships. This is the page where the NAP members area is on our Eden website. Here you have a list of the services that and the benefits that membership could imply. Don't forget, I won't read them all, but don't forget that being an institutional member can help having 30 individuals in the NAP, which is a very good reward in my view. There are discounted purchases related to Eden publications, lots of electronic news letters and news flashes from the Eden Secretariat, which is supporting us so much every time we have any kind of event, and we really thank them for that. We try to work and to support members, especially through social media and of course interactive channels. We work as a professional development committee, so this is our main concern. And that is why we try to offer a very intense and varied series of webinars as the one Chiara Zuanni is going to give us today. Just to remind you again, our conference, annual conference, and the meeting that we will have as an app there, called Road to Bruges, and to from Bruges to other events and opportunities of meeting and of building relationship that we are going to have from Bruges onwards. The conference will be held from June 16 to June 19, so don't miss it, and don't forget the Eden chat later today. Anyway, I don't want to steal more time to Chiara, so Chiara, please, the floor is yours, and we are really looking forward to hear your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you, Antonella and Cristina, first of all, for inviting me. It's great to have this opportunity to talk about my work. And today I wanted to give you an overview of a range of digital learning and engagement perspective and approaches in museums. And I thought of starting by discussing what actually museums do in terms of learning and how to go behind the learning to talk about values and the other type of experiences that visitors might be seeking in museums. Then I thought of very briefly talking about what happens in the gallery, and then to focus on what most of my research is about, that is social media and social media analysis to understand museum visitors. And so to start with, I would start with a traditional definition of a museum, which I imagine you all know. It's the definition by the ICOM from 2017, which is now being rewritten. And it says that a museum is a non-profit permanent institution in the service of society and its development, open to the public, and which acquires, conserves, researches, communicates, and exhibits the tangible and intangible heritage of humanity and its environment for the purposes of education, study, and enjoyment. And already from these definitions, we can see that education and study are only a part of what museums do. They are also valuable for enjoyment and for conservation of our shared heritage. And this is a taxonomy of various values offered by museums, which has been developed in a report by the University of Leicester in the UK, in which they try to map all the possibilities of user experiences and the consequent values that visitors can have. And they start from the main actions, which are like engaging with all its different processes of engaging users, which can go from questioning, reflecting, discovery, but also being challenged, being confronted, being shocked by museum exhibits. And these various types of engagement and relationships that can be built can lead to different feelings, of which well-being is an important one. And well-being, it can mean enjoyment, but it can mean being also inspiration. It can also be in healing and psychological well-being. And I know that Antonella is working a lot on that, actually. And this can lead to an enhanced sense of self, so more confidence, feeling more competent, feeling better about oneself. And at the same time, it can lead also to connect with other people, other experiences, but also with other cultures, with other communities. And so to create the museums as a real forum for people to connect with each other. And in this, we see that learning is only a part. A museum can do much better. And this is what I will talk about besides the first learning outcomes that museums can have. And this is also reflected by the way we can look at visitors, because we can look at visitors as learners, but we can also use different segmentations. This is one example of one by Morris, Hargraves and McIntyre, in which they profile visitors and according to few categories like essence, which is a visitor who tend to be well-educated, is a discerning cultural consumer, is confident in its own taste and pay little attention to what others think. price quality and sophistication in the art is what it's looking for. And this is a very different way to, let's say, categorize visitors in comparison to just learners of various groups. If we look only at learners, I still like these definitions by Upper Greenhill, although it's 20 years old, in which she says that museums are no better at imparting information than other places. And their strength is instead in increasing the motivation to learn, in enabling people to discover and develop new passions. And this is really what museums are good at, in my opinion. And an example that museums are no better at imparting information than other places is this series of case studies from my own previous research, in which I was asking visitors in the gallery of the museums to sketch a map of what they remembered. So they had just gone through an archaeology and an Egyptology gallery. They had been looking at panels, they had been reading labels, and I was waiting for them just at the end of it and being like, can you please draw a map, sketching the map of a gallery and signaling somehow, highlighting the objects you remember best. So one visitor drew me this map with a dinosaur that he considered part of the archaeology gallery. And instead, this is not a dinosaur, it is an elephant, and it is in a gallery adjacent to the archaeology one. So it has nothing to do with archaeology, and it's definitely not a dinosaur, and there is plenty of interactive panels that explain that. But still, its idea that something close to archaeology is dinosaurs was stronger than any kind of other interpretation the museum was offering in this moment. In another case, there was a mass display of Roman lamps that you can see in the top right corner of the slide, and this visitor defined them as candle holders. So in this case, he didn't know how an ancient Roman lamps worked, but he thought it's something that makes light. I don't know exactly how it works, so I just stick a candle in the middle of this lamp, and this is how this object worked in the past. Same thing for a collection of Egyptian artifacts called shaptis that had a lot of interpretation, and during which the visitors had been observing a lot and discussing with me because I was visiting the gallery with him. But she still couldn't remember that they were Egyptian artifacts or that they were called shapti, and she called them blue statuettes. So in this way, we can say that museums really are not the best for imparting information, but they can still inspire visitors to go beyond and learn a bit more. And they can do that through formal and informal learning approach, because they can support formal learning, like during school groups, school visits, educational programs. But they can also support informal learning and long-time learning. Through visitors like me, who's an archaeologist by background and goes in a science museums and will always come up having learned something new. And at the same time, museums also education and so on can relate to educational theories and as developed by behaviorist approach to more constructivist one, or in other words, from discussing passive learners to consider visitors as active learners and co-producers of meaning, or even co-producers of exhibition and interpretation. And in this context, it is worth mentioning the notion of participatory cultures, as proposed by Jenkins for American education institutions in 2006, in which he said that participatory cultures are those in which not every member must contribute, but all must believe that they are free to contribute when ready, and that what they contribute will be appropriately valued. And this notion has been picked up in the museum field by Nina Simon with a book which is free to download as PDF on her website, and in which she talk about participatory museums, defining a participatory cultural institution as a place where visitors can create, share, and connect with each other around content. And the goal of this participatory technique, which could be from co-production to eliciting visitors' answers with interactive, also not necessarily digital, is to meet visitor expectation for active engagement and do so in a way that can also further the mission and core values of the institution. And in this museum, in a participatory museum, both visitors and staff are basically contributing to the interpretation, to the meaning making of exhibits, and to bring forward the mission of the museum itself. And this model is also well reflected in terms of in the visitor experience model, which was developed a bit before by Falk. Falk and Dierking have been working on the museum learning since the mid-90s, and this is just a graph from one of the latest interpretation of the visitor's experience and identity model. And Falk wrote that the long-term meanings created by visitors from their time in the museums are largely shaped by short-term personal identity-related needs and interest rather than by the goals and intentions of the museum staff. This basically means that the visitors going to the museums every time with a personal context, who they are, their interest, their tiredness in that moment, and so on. And they encounter a physical context, the way the museum and the gallery is prepared, the design, the route they take, the itinerary they have to take through the exhibits, and they are immersed in a socio-cultural context. So the people they visit with and the other visitors around them, because if a gallery is very crowded or there are only two or three visitors inside, this will give us different experiences and different feelings. And every time these three contexts, the personal, the physical, and the socio-cultural, encounter each other in the museums, they create a feeling and experience for the visitors, which will go out to the museums thinking that this need has been satisfied by the museum visit and he has reinforced a certain characteristic of his identity and his relationship with museums. And so he would be prompted to go back into the museum again. Or he might end up having a very negative experience because the museum was too crowded, because the exhibit was not well designed, and so on, which might affect his future perception of his needs and how a museum can satisfy these, and thus prompting him to turn away next time, for example. And if we think how these three contexts can come together during every museum visit, a user visualization of that is that of a visitor journey derived from customer journeys that can be done in marketing or in every other type of enterprise, in which the journey of a customer, the visitor in a museum case, is analyzed not only during the visit but also before and after. So this is a great visualization that I particularly like from the Australian Centre for the Moving Image, in which they try to think at the visitors' journeys in this centre, which has a lot of digital art as a cinema, as a lot of exhibitions on digital cultures and so on. And the visitor journey really, in this case, starts from planning the visit, finding out which events are on, how to get to the museums, whether that day there is an exhibit we are particularly interested in, to a wayfinding stage in which the visitor is trying to find the museum, trying to find his way to the ticket office and trying to get in, and to what happens once he arrives at the ticket office and even before at the door, how is it welcomed by the staff, whether there are queues or not, whether there are all the services he might need or not, and so on, and during the visit, of course. So, for example, I'm thinking of museums with a lot of digital interactive. Do the screen actually work, or are they already gone off service? Or can the visitors satisfy his curiosity for certain topics or not? Is there an app that works and that the visitor has to download and that requires times and the Wi-Fi connection might not be good or everything flow smoothly? And that's basically some of the way we can analyze, analyze how visitors travel across the museums and get an experience out of it, or learn something in the case of learning experiences. And now I want to focus a bit more just on digital learning and tools that can be used in the gallery of the museums to enhance that. And the first is actually interactive, which have a long stories because they can be very analog. This is a typical analog interactive in which a visitor is asked some questions, he answers them, he scores some points, for example, how often do you recycle plastic? If you do it regularly, 5 points, and so on and so on. And how often do you buy biological food or questions like that? And the sum of a point can be scored on a column, which kind of classify the visitors in different type of eco-friendly consumers. And this is all done in a very analog way. Similar, this is interactive from a children's science center about chameleon with just a screen that just change colors. They are light based and some button to push to see how the chameleon works, if this can be said of an animal. And interactive in science center have a long history and even before digital. But moving on to digital, now there are digital interactives that can allow visitors to explore other aspects of the collections. And this is, for example, in the Weltmuseum in Vienna. It is a very big table in which there are a few screens. The visitors can choose one object, one bubble, as you can see on the right lower side. And by choosing this object, this statuette, they can explore a series of related subtopics, which can be a short video with an interview to the curator. It can be a look at the other related collections. It can be texted presenting some aspect of it. Or it can be interactive surveys, like the one on the lower left corner, in which there was a question, should the Weltmuseum Vienna also put objects of souvenir art on display? Visitors could vote about that. And after this, they will see the results of everyone who has voted before them. And this is a way to offer more information for people who want to learn something more, but also include visitors who might not be interested in learning, but more in sharing their opinion and in participating in the museum life. Another way, instead, probably more learning focus, is that of using learning digital tools to enhance interpretation. And that's the London Mitraeum, who opened last year, in which in the first room there is a wall with a lot of objects and fragments of objects who have been found during the excavation in this place, posited on a wall, but in very clear delimited square. And the purpose of having all these squares is because when the visitor is given a tablet, which has visualizations with the same square, with the same object, so that visitors can easily find the object they want to know more about. And just by clicking on it, they will get an image, a basic definition and date, and then they can swipe left and find out more information. And in this case, this became almost a gamification approach in some ways, because visitors can really just play like a battleship and do square, first square left from third row there, click on the objects, look what it is, swipe left or right a bit, find a short video, find some text. And this becomes a way of conveying information, but in a friendly and fun way, actually, because one is tempted to stay there and play battleship with this wall for a while. A different type of app instead is that, for example, of the Louvre, or that is actually a model common to many institutions, in which the visitor has to download the app on its phone. And that's a first problem because there might be Wi-Fi connections, or just think of visitors in an institution like the Louvre that are international, and they might not want to use their data plan to download a big app. And if the Wi-Fi is not fast enough, they might also be bored of waiting for the app to download. But once they manage to download it, they can find basic information about the museum, from the opening times to the prices, even buy the ticket online and so on. They can find the maps, which snapshot of where the most important work of art are, and where are also not only works of art but also services, like for example toilets, cafe, entrances and exits, or shops, which are things that are always interesting for museum visitors. Probably if we ask a visitor's assistant what is the most frequent question, it would be where is the toilet, or where is the lift. And then they can click on the snapshot of the various objects and find out a bit of more information. Like in the case of the Victory of Samothrace, they can find a short audio describing it and related objects, other Greek objects, Greek collections, and so on. And this model is basically a way of transforming the audio guide into an app, which includes also a map and includes orienteering and wayfinding tools, as well as additional services, and has been taken up by many institutions. A different and innovative project is instead that of the Brooklyn Museums, who developed an app which is called Ask Brooklyn Museum. And visitors can literally ask questions to staff members. There is a team of staff members, which includes an archaeologist, an anthropologist, art historians, and educators, who are always ready to answer any question received via the app. And so the visitor can basically chat with them during the visit, and it might just start with the visitor asking a question about a work of art, but then the staff member will prompt them to look for more. So I can ask, I'm in front of this painting, can you give some more information about it? The curator will answer, but then it will also tell me, have you noticed that specific details in that corner? What do you think of it? And so I can start to have a conversations and getting engaged into that, and by this way, learning also something more. And in the case of the Brooklyn Museums, there is a staff answering the questions, but other museums have tried to develop similar systems using bots. For example, in Italy, there is an app done, the first app of this type was done by the MART Museum in Rovereto in Trentino, which used Telegram and a bot to help visitors identify painting and get more information about them. The latest trend instead in terms of in galleries supporting digital tools is that of augmented reality and of virtual reality. This one I particularly like it because it's based on Wikitude, which is a system to develop augmented reality apps, which allow you to create your own markers. So in this case, it was the Franklin Museum, also in the state, which had an exhibition of so the Terracotta Warriors. And they basically created marker with the image of the warriors. And by scanning them, people will get them in augmented reality with more information because they were annotated so that visitors can look, for example, at the weapons they are holding in their hands. But at the same time, this can be done in the gallery and outside. So I did it on my own laptop, sitting in my bedroom, just by scanning the PDF markers. And the other trend is instead that of virtual reality. And the first museums to use that, to my knowledge, was the British Museum, which used in virtual reality in 2015 to recreate a Bronze Age house in which they located all the objects from the museum collection so that visitors could see how these objects were in the original context. And virtual reality has been a trend that we have all seen growing in recent years, since 2015, and being taken up by a few museums. A totally different approach, also in 2015, is that of the Cooper Hewitt, which is the design museum of the Smithsonian, who developed the pen. And I will just leave some links here in the presentation if it will be shared, but then you can just Google for the pen. Since it won a lot of awards. which is basically allows visitors to scan objects. So if they like some objects on the label, there is a symbol they can scan with a pen. And out of that, they can get more information. They can bookmark it so that when they go back home, they can find it again and interact with it. But at the same time, in the museums, there are some big tables to which the visitors can connect via the pen and look at the objects they have bookmarked on these tables and interact with them to create, for example, new design patterns out of a textile they liked. And this was a way to not only allow visitors to get more information, but also to get creative. And since this is a design museum, develop their own creative skills in this direction. And this is just a quick survey of apps, and I'm sure you all know many more of them. Something that is still very debated is what's the impact of this app on the audiences. And this is a photo of school children in the Rijksmuseums, which went viral in 2014 when visitors to the museums took this photo and posted it on Facebook, commenting, "What are these children doing? They are in an art museum, they are sitting next to Rembrandt Night Watch, and they're just looking at their phone. This is a disaster for the future of education," and so on. And this image went viral, and it was picked up by the teacher of these children, who actually said that they were using the app by the Rijksmuseum because they were doing a small exercise in which they had to find out information about works of art, and they had to find that by using the app, which is very similar to that of the Louvre. So there are services, there is a map, more information about each object. And this app was launched. In 2012, when the museum reopened, and has been an award-winning app that allows people to do different tours across galleries, find objects based on their artists, and so on, and again bookmark them and find them later on in the Rijks studio. So this is, but it was not perceived in 2014 as educational by the visitor observing these children. And the actual impact of these apps, it's something that is still kind of debated. One aspect is just that of user experience. So is the app easy and pleasant to use, or is just taking a lot of time to load and it is not useful, or the videos are boring, I don't know, and visitors just refuse to use them. And the way to looking at this is to look at analytics, so actual usage of the apps under this subsection, which pages are more used than others and for how long. And this is useful for museums who want to develop their apps further and check whether they work or not. And this can be, of course, integrated with in galleries visitor studies and also with reactions on press and media or social media, which is kind of a way to see how people talk about this app outside of the museums. And that's what I want to talk now about, but I don't know if you have any questions you want to put in the chat quickly or something. I give you,
But first,
or you want to activate your yeah.
I wanted to thank you, first of all, for this really interesting presentation. And of course, I have lots of questions for you, as you might imagine. The first one is related to this idea that you presented throughout the whole presentation of engaging the visitors, the potential learners, the public, let's say so. So, which is your idea, your personal idea? I mean, coming from your studies related to this need of engaging people. Do you think that this kind of technology is helpful? Do you have evidence for that? Here you are mentioning questions, comments, press and media, and social media reaction, and so on and so forth. But do you think there's still a space, let's say, to measure this kind of involvement, and to which point should we force this involvement.
I think we shouldn't force it, but we should allow visitors who want to have this sort of experience to have it in a positive way. And I think one of the problems with apps is that sometimes we expect too much out of them, and we expect visitors to get a lot out of them, or every visitor to use them, and that's not what's happened. Because in many cases, visitors come to the museums also to look at the real objects, so to say. And the apps is a support that they might choose or not to use. And in many cases, actually, they don't really want to use it because they prefer to just focus on what is in front of them rather than on the screen of their phones. So I think in this case, something like the Mitraeum is very engaging because it is a tablet that is already provided and works well. And people can use it on this case, but then they can go on and look at the actual archaeological remains of the Mitraeum, and they have a different experience in this other room of the Mitraeum. But I think the best answer to your question is in the next slide, which is on social media, in which led me to the second part of to the last part of this short seminar. And it's a graph I did in trying to understand how the museums and the audiences can interact on social media and what does it mean to engage public there. And I start from seeing the museum as the main actor to the audiences. So in the first case, I have the museums which create contents or broadcast, and the public is just a spectator. And in this case, it's the classic museums that announces a talk, for example, or talks about its collections, but it's just broadcasting, it's not provoking any kind of a response from the public or looking for it. Then there is a phase in which the museums try to engage more in conversations with the public, and this could be by encouraging target group to share, so having Insta swap or influencers day in the museums. Or a special day in which, for example, when there was Pokémon Go, a lot of visitors were just going into the museums to play Pokémon Go, and museums were prompting this group, the gamers of Pokémon Go, to come in. And then museums can also encourage everyone to share. They can have selfie spot in the gallery, or they can participate in online campaign like Museum Week, ask curators, in which people are encouraged to participate and ask questions, share their content, and so on. And then there is another phase in which the museums does not really have a lot of agency because it's all in the hands of the public. And this is when the public just share content. The visitors who go into a museum share a post on Instagram, or the visitors who read a news about a museum. And then just start to comment about this news. And in this case, I think this is a different graph of engagement, which doesn't really go, which goes beyond the physical space of a museum. So I see now Alistair questions about virtual tours as a pre-visit activity, or for those who cannot physically visit the museums. That's what social media can offer, for example, with Facebook Lives during exhibitions opening and Twitter Day, Influencers Day in a museum, so just to check out what's going on. And for example, I was working at the Victoria and Albert Museum last year, and when they opened the Sackler Courtyard, the new entrance, they did a session for the press only. And then they did a session for influencers only. So influencers were invited to come in and share their post everywhere. So that was also a way of doing marketing. And on the other way, social media can also be used within the museum community. So for example, museum hours on Monday evening is another chat, like hidden chat for a museum professional. And what I'm interested in doing is mining all this data to understand engagement, online engagement. And when I do that, I think this allows me to go behind the analytics of each platform, like Facebook Insights, Twitter Analytics, which can give engagement rate for post or reach, number of people who might or might not have seen a post, because actually reach is about on how many people a post has appeared, but that doesn't guarantee that the person has actually read the post. And data mining, social media allows to go beyond that and get a richer understanding of what's going on and to research public engagement and perceptions of a museum. And I just show you quickly two examples, probably, of that. One is participation during Museum Week in Italy. And I chose this example because in 2016 there was Museum Week, this week in which museums are basically using a single hashtag, Museum Week, and then a hashtag for each day of the week to talk about their collections and their institutions. And it's a campaign that there is every year. This year is the third week of May, if I remember rightly. And in 2016, all the newspapers were saying that Italy has been one of the most active users. And so I was standing out as this article for La Stampa said. And I was reading this and I was thinking, why, what's going on? So I collected all the tweets from Museum Week of that week. And this is Italy, the one in the red box, in which you see that the blue column, the number of tweets, is really high. So we really tweeted a lot. But the number of users, the orange column, is kind of inferior to that of French, English, or Spanish user, for example. So this graph tells me that few users posted a huge lot, and I wanted to see who these users were. So I looked at all the people who tweeted from Italy during this week, which is about 1,400 users. And the first two columns in the graph, the two highest blue column, are people which I couldn't really identify. Mostly for privacy reasons, because on their Twitter profile they weren't giving any particular information about who they were, and I didn't want to go beyond to look for more information about them because I wanted to respect their privacy and what they had chosen to share about themselves on this platform. But then, if you ignore the first two columns, you have got a series of orange columns, which are people who were already affiliated with the heritage sector. So the tallest orange column is museum and institutions, but then I've got museum and heritage studies students. I got bloggers in the art sectors. I've got professionals. I've got cultural associations and so on. And I got very few blue column, which is other users, but also restaurants or commercial activities near museums, which saw that Museum Week was trending. And so, for example, it could have been a restaurant that said, I'm next to the Uffizi. If you're visiting the museum during Museum Week, come to have lunch by me afterwards. So people were just promoting their activity using this hashtag. And then there were a few journalists and media outlets. And out of all these, museums are the one who tweeted the most. But when I looked at the content of these tweets, they were also the one who tweeted the less about what they were supposed to tweet about during Museum Week. So in this graph, you have got on the top left this pie, which is about the content analysis of a tweet shared by people active in the heritage sector, so museums and professional and museum students. And on the other column, you have got people who are not active in the heritage sector, so tourists, but also commercial activity and so on. And the colors in this pie are the type of tweets. So this dark red brownish color, it's tweets about socializing, so people talking to each other, but not about museum, just in general, networking, so to say. And you can see that this is the main activity done by museum professionals. The green activity is what they were supposed to do, so to talk about the museum, its objects, its collections, and its activities. And the people who did so the most are people that were not active in the heritage sector, So tourists visiting the museum on these days who picked up on Hashtag and used it to develop, to share their impressions from the visit. And in this sense, I used this research to evaluate how Museum Week has been great for developing professional networks among the Italian heritage community, but it has been less good for to engage visitors and people who were already not in the sector to reach new users or new potential audiences. And audiences were people who were coming already to the museum, so to say. And a different case instead I want to show you that is more focused on learning is instead that of a spinning statuette. And this is a case from my PhD thesis, and it is basically a viral video which you can find on YouTube and has been seen more than 4 million times, which was shared in June 2013, and in which there was a statuette in Manchester Museum, the black one in this image that you can probably see just on the background, that was filmed moving on its own out of it. Out of its own control in the museum case. And the museum posted the video saying this statuette might be moving because of the abrasion, which was indeed the cause, or it might be moving because of some mysterious reason we don't know anything about. And of course, this picked up on people's imagination about ancient Egypt. People interested in mysteries in museums and so on, and it was shared everywhere and picked up by news everywhere. And these pins are different colors because they are about where news outlets versus tweets and other type of post. But this is basically where this status was shared, and I collected data about it at the time. Which meant I collected more than 15,000 tweets, more than 600 newspapers articles, and a little less than 3,000 comments below these news articles, as well as a few YouTube videos and blog posts. I gathered some quick quantitative data, so for example, geolocation, so to do these maps, apps and devices that people use to share the news. The timeline. So this is the weekend during which it went viral, and you can see that it was a very short-lived episode that over 4 days it received most of its shares. And the most tweeted links, which gave me an idea of which news sources people were using to read about this episode and share it. And that, of course, when by doing a press analysis and seeing how different newspapers were talking about it, led me to understand what people read and that we were talking about the episode. And an example is this one. Many people were reading about the statuette and were just using references to popular culture. So, Egyptian statuette that moves in a mysterious way, Night at the Museum was an obvious reference, Indiana Jones and the Mummy, and these were like references I was expecting. References I wasn't really expecting, but kind of understood was Doctor Who, because in Doctor Who there are the Weeping Angels, which are these monsters that basically move if people don't look at them. And so people were saying, don't blink, what the doctor says in this episode to the victim of these angels. People were talking even about Sherlock Holmes, were talking about Harry Potter. So, for example, I didn't expect this at all, but I found people mentioning Horcruxes and saying maybe the statuette is an Horcrux. People were talking about Illuminati theory, and actually, there was a long video, probably the longest YouTube response to this episode, which was done by someone who felt affiliated with Illuminati. And basically, said that the statuette moving on its own was a symbol of the end of the world, and that this video with a lot of biblical citations, for example, a passage from the book of Isaiah, in which it is said that when the idols of Egypt start to move, it means that the apocalypse is coming, and so on. And then, of course, I looked also at other ideas about perception of ancient Egypt and so on. And by mining this data, I could understand what people thought of the museum, what people thought of ancient Egypt, and also how people were, in some cases, engaging in conversation and trying to learn something, and in other cases, were just engaging in a fun way, very interesting, just in a curious episode, which was funny to share for an afternoon, but that was it. And this episode, when this is another visualization of how far it was shared everywhere. And just quickly, I want to conclude by giving you some overview of the problems with the data mining in social media, because the problem is that there is a lot of choice and a lot of platform, and we can always choose which one to use and which one, because we cannot get all the data from all the platforms. That will be a titanic job. At the same time, to mine platform, in some cases we need the data science skills, because we need to go through the API, or we need to scrape the web, and so we need to know some Python or some R code. And there are a lot of ethical and legal problems. So, for example, in the case of a museum week in Italy, I didn't mine more than I didn't look for users beyond Twitter, because I wanted to keep only within the platform and what they chose to share on that. And that's basically everything on social media mining. But I see Antonella questions on the Brooklyn Museum app and the interactive dimension. So I don't know if Antonella, do you want to share it with the mic?
You know, I'm very curious, because I wanted to know more about this app at the Brooklyn Museum. Do you know if there are data related to the kind of interaction that people can have through this application? And also, I'm very curious about who are those answering the questions from the public.
This one, I don't have data top of my mind in this
Yeah,
moment, but I think they did
but you
a
know,
paper
just
for
because
Museum and the Web
it was
a couple of years
really
ago.
interesting, and this idea of, you know, enhancing interactivity to this point is very, very interesting. I think we should go deeper, and but we'll have the opportunity to do so. So I see time is
Definitely,
running. I
yeah, I think.
really thank you. I don't know if there are other questions. Let's see if someone is still typing something. Anyway, in the meantime, I really want to thank you, Chiara, because it was absolutely enlightening, and it's really stimulating. Here, all of you have Chiara's references, her email, her Twitter account. So please contact her. We are in close connection, so I will have the opportunity to ask further questions to Chiara. But don't hesitate and contact her. I'm sure she will give you more details about her research and her studies, which are so engaging and relevant in the society, contemporary society we are living, and the problems we are experiencing, especially in Europe. So, thanks so much to Chiara. Big applause, even if at a distance. I just wanted to remind. Thanks to you, really. Thanks to
Thanks
you
to you for inviting me.
for your availability, both at the Eden Chat and for the webinar. I just wanted to remind all of you that we are going to have another webinar next May the 8th with Palita Dirisinga from Leicester University. And the webinar will be on the use of digital literacy by university students. Later tonight, we are going to have an hidden chat, as I was mentioning you, the hidden secretariat, which I really thank, is typing the information related to next Eden app webinar. And at 6, don't miss our Eden chat. Tonight we'll have Pedro Cabral from UAB Portugal, and the chat will be on designing online courses using the interaction equivalent theorem. So very, very interesting chat again. In Bruges, yes, we haven't reminded that in Bruges we will have also a PhD symposium. So all the PhDs that are there, and I know there are lots of you, please don't forget to participate in our PhD symposium. All the information are on the website. So thank you again. Happy Easter to all of you, and have a nice spring break. Thank you again. Bye bye.